one, please.
Okay. Do you need one?
Yes, ma'am.
Picture most of the time. Nay, I want to tell you two words.
Hold on a sec. And I said, well, we've always been friends. I never told you you weren't when you were my kid's manager. I said, in fact, he was cooing over you yesterday. But she says, well, who does it?
Her hair. I'm like, yeah, you gotta love us all, but
she's married.
She's
married. Well, I can still admire her.
Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes we're gonna have to lose. Ain't about
am worried about it.
It's charging.
I know.
Blow some bubbles. Okay, Miss Sterling, Lindsey, is that what you're aiming for? Anyway, I just thought I'd show you my office. It's a maker space, but I call it my office with my family. Let's see here. Let's plug it so you can see that. Yeah, okay, so here it is. This is, you know, this is like geek heaven, actually. Right here is some filament from a company called Zenny Kinetic. A big old sign right now in Salt Lake, empty building, because that company failed. I had nothing to do with it. I came out here afterwards. That's the 3D printer, freaking cool thing. That's the computer that runs it. I don't know. Let's check. Work, okay. Well, there you go. Check. You recognize that? Okay. Anyway, this is my freaking cult, actually. I got this computer recently, and it told me, welcome to the cult of Razer. So, yeah, I guess I'm in a cult of Razer, whatever that is. It's a gaming computer, so I guess that's our thing. This is my gear. I put yellow tape on it just to be careful. My Oculus gear. VR, I had to get it when I experienced Natureverse, when Will showed that to me. It was just like absolutely amazing. My first experience was Natureverse, the baby one, Evolution of Verse. It was just one of the most beautiful things I experienced that wasn't in reality. So yeah, my grip on reality might be forsaken. I do know though that I am a hypnotist. I have been trained. This is like a good friend of mine's, and we put this server rack in here. You know, I probably hadn't had any of that in a while, but so yeah, and this is, this one you'll recognize. Yeah, Windows 8, whatever, man. Maybe they're doing a little better. They just bought LinkedIn. So, but I've been trying to been a little bit more loving with Zing.com. They are little German stuff, little cameras. They can, you know, see what's going on here. And this is a 3D camera, you know. Me, I guess I've been on like a little spiritual journey for a long time, and I lost kind of sight of, I kind of lost sight of, you, I don't know, you know, the, around 2008, I was really trying to understand, you know, why I believed in the Book of Mormon so much, and it was a really, you know, existence afterwards and stuff. And I have to be honest with you, the examples that I seen in the church were not what I wanted to be in. And so you know, I don't know really. I do know that I was in Goleta, California, or, you know, and there's like every single defense contractor in America or even is in, has an office in Goleta. And one of my best friends, his name is Mike. I don't know. I guess I do miss Mike, but he hates California. Me, Utah, well, the beach, I loved the ocean, and honestly, I was just freaking, I don't do freaking drugs, but I do smoke weed sometimes, and I was smoking it all the time in freaking California, man, and the beaches, and just relaxing, and just doing stuff. But the thing is like, I thought that I was being an activist. There's this guy named Saul Alinsky, and right before this guy named Professor died, I asked him, you know, did you write the book, Rules for Radicals? And, you know, in the book, I believe it's like, you know, don't freaking, I'm a Dutch-Irish black Jew. And when he said that to me, when I met him, I was like, okay, this guy's Saul Alinsky. Anyway, it doesn't really matter. When he's like, yeah, I burnt the bank down. Yeah, I was the one that burnt the bank down. I read the sealed portion and Rules for Radicals about the freaking same time. And, well, you know, the thing is like, this Thursday, I'm going up to Salt Lake. It's, you know, people in Utah, they complain about 20-minute drive. Freak, man, I'm from Riverside, California, and whatever, man. Drive an hour to go wherever, doesn't matter. But I'm going up to Salt Lake, and there's this meet, and there's this guy that, well, he claimed, let me put it this way. Okay, so let's say like 200 years ago, you know, I'm just, you know, Joseph Smith, he's just, you know, going through a trip, and he stumbles upon, you know, somewhere, and he got found, you know, a big block, like the golden plates, 400 pounds of gold. Okay, that freaking big. Okay, that freaking big, 400 pounds. Oh, I won't believe you if you don't show me the golden plates. Oh yeah, I'm just gonna really show you my 400 pounds of gold so you can jack it from me. Yeah, right. So, yeah, in that box also, there was Thurman Thummums and a sword. There's no one freaking talks about the sword, but it's in there. And so, yeah, that's, if there was anything like, I could talk to Chris to be like, no, like, I believe him. The thing is like, when I read the Book of Mormon, they say that, you know, some people say, well, like, it's either because he's a genius and he was just uneducated, so that wasn't possible, or it's the work of God. Okay. Well, I understand, because there is a feeling that you have when you, you know, read it and pray about it and stuff. But You know, there's also like a different feeling, kind of similar in some of the other Orthodox or the non-denominational churches. Oh, my freaking mission. I served in Richmond, Virginia. And, I was trying to understand where other people come from and stuff like that. And when they say, you know, the Bible is the only word of God and there will never be anything else and didn't add to or take away from this book. Okay, well, at least the guy at my MTC trained us pretty well on that. And he was like, you know, first of all, it's in Deuteronomy. Don't add to or take away this book. La Biblia means many books. It's Greek for many books. I mean, and honestly, like, the Bible was compiled 400 at the Nicene Creed when a bunch of leaders got together and voted on what would be in the Bible. But, you know, what sets, I think, Mormonism apart from rest is like, the belief in the three Nephites that were still alive, and that John the Revelator never died. So, like, the thing is like, they do believe that if they just know what to look for and what to believe in the documentation or any kind of mythology, whatever, and stuff. And, so, really, it's not really that unfeasible that, you know, he's going around testing people or helping people or doing whatever he needs to do to fulfill, you know, the plan of salvation. Lindsey, I have this vague memory of watching America's Got Talent or a show like that a long freaking time ago. I remember even some of my friends from high school over in my house. And I was in this, like, every once in a while. You know, in the movie The Scorpion, or the TV show Scorpion, they said this, you know, they call it going down the rabbit hole. And so, like, I say, yeah, it's either I'm going down the rabbit hole or I'm being caught up in the spirit. So, really, reality sometimes gets a little fuzzy for me, but honestly, when somebody that is like me can't fall in love with a YouTube personality, you know, fall in love, actually think that there could be something, you know what I'm saying? The thing is Lindsey, I don't know, like I said, I remember watching that, and I was remember, and I don't think that this is a false memory, trying to tell the judges. I remember, like, having, like, some type of wild card, and telling them, yeah, I love that girl. It's funny, because I think my girlfriend at the time was there at the house. I was like, that girl, I loved her. Just picked you out of the lineup while you were lining up. I wish I could have some footage of them doing the cameras and stuff, but, you know, the thing is that kind of thing is makes me believe that, yeah, I'm an asset to the American government because I've done other things to help communications and stuff. Just weird stuff that I can't explain to anybody. Nobody freaking believed me. And here's why I think that you would, or at least there is the possibility that you would accept my love and be with me, and I could be with you. It's the fact that most people, you know, I guess they just, you know, love themselves, love their situation, so much. And every once in a while, I'll meet somebody that I know is going to be in the, you know, celestial kingdom. Forget the pre-prayers. I don't think that matters as much. You can't work your way into heaven, which was a big deal there, and now I kind of understand what they mean by that. And at the time, in 2001, there was a lot of people, like Baptists, they were really going for that Mormon church. I mean, we were hated, you know, the pastors would just say most evil stuff about the church and this and that. I never believed them, shake them off and stuff like that. But when I read this guy's book, they says he translated from the Golden Plates, I felt like it really was Moroni speaking in that. In Ether, it does talk about, you know, if you haven't heard of the sealed portion, well, you're a missionary. You had to have heard of it. I don't know, though. But the thing is in the sealed portion, in the Ether, it talks about, you know, the most miracle, most best thing that made manifest to mankind, and the vision of the Jared, the vision of before, you know, Adam and Eve until after. And so that's a really huge thing that, you know, Joseph Smith translated into the Book of Mormon. That promise that it's like, you know, just far and away above, like, the best thing ever given to mankind. This little portion. So, you know, and you look at some of the pictures of in Mormon church, you see the bands and stuff like that. And incidentally, it's also like the Mormon church history, the lost manuscript. So this guy, Christopher, he says he translated that. So I guess, you know, for a while I was really hung up on you know, my faith, why I believe in the Book of Mormon, and yet not whoever the freaking president of that church was. So, yeah, I just didn't understand. But when I read the sealed portion, I was just like, wow, it's awesome. And incidentally, it was up here I met some guy, and I was hanging out with him and working, and I saw a book, and I was like, oh, crazy, that's a book that I'd like to see, you know? And he's like, oh, no, that, you know, this book? But you probably really wanted this book, the sealed portion. Oh, shit, the sealed portion? Holy cow, really? And I guess I was in a space where I could believe that, you know, the promised two-thirds could have came out. You know what I'm saying? Back in California, right before I got here and found out about the sealed portion, I was talking to this guy, his name was Bob Stern, and he was a very Orthodox Jew. He even was trained by some Rebbe and stuff, and he was teaching me stuff about the Kabbalah. And it was just like, whoa, you know what I'm saying? And I was searching, you know, not necessarily for truth. Maybe I just had to think, am I going to exist after I die, you know? Really? That's all, you know. Then, if I could have that base, then, you know, it doesn't really matter if I understand what's going to happen afterwards. At least, like, isn't that, like, one of the points of believing in a religion, you know? All of them have a theory of the afterlife, you know? So, whatever. And today, I think it comes down to people that don't really want religion. Freak. I understand, you know. It just depends on really what it is that you love about it, I think. Me, I just want a reality, you know. why was I any different as a Mormon than these Baptists that were saying, you know, their theories or Jehovah's Witness, which a Jehovah's Witness. I would go, I never been to a Jehovah's Witness meeting, but it would be nice, but I just have these problems communicating. Like, I just don't know how to communicate with them unless it was at work. I started a company called Channel Laundry in Santa Barbara, but I was going to deliver laundry, wash. It was going to be a clothing. Oh my gosh. Let me just say that I've had some really special people in and out of my life. One person that I am worried about and that I can't do anything for is this woman named Wendy Zan. And, you know, for some weird reason, people have always, Corinne and Mudita were the only ones that nobody really tried to keep us apart, but, interesting, I met someone recently, reminding me a lot of Corinne, my first girlfriend, and met her out. She was out here. I was actually going to go to a virtual reality meetup at the Dev Mountain. I got here real early because I was really excited about going to this virtual reality meetup. And so I got so early that I couldn't go in. And so I'm walking over that viaduct from the bus train, from the transit over to the temple and university, and there's this woman, and she's like, it's raining, so like, hey, you want to come over to the freaking makerspace, my office? Sure. She's all like, and then we get into this real spiritual like discussions and stuff like that, and I'm not talking about like Christianity kind of spirituality. It's just like, you know, I tell her that, you know, I believe I'm the king of the leprechauns. No, it's just a framework for me to understand how it would be like, because it talks about, you know, some of the things that I've read on what I would like to do. You know, what makes someone a good man, you know, and, anyway, she's like, she's the oracle. I was like, what's your name? You know, well, let's say my name's Jackie. Okay. Well, anyway, we just talk. I mean, goodness, it's just, we're able to elevate our spiritual plane to be able to communicate on just an awesome level. But we're just like, she don't have much time. She's not homeless, even though she was in hippie garb. But anyway, I take her back to my grandpa's farm on the bus. I have a dog with me. The dog just ran away. Oh my god. But the dog comes back and she comes back with me and we just talk. I take her to Taco Bell. Just stuff. She tells me that some type of producer for really famous people. Can't tell her who, because, you know, it's kind of private stuff. We need to protect these artists, you know. So yeah, I've had that experience. That was very recent, so I know that was real. Also, there was a twin. What's interesting about those twins is like, okay, so one of the things I think Moroni says in the book, in the sealed portion, the final testament. Jesus Christ. It's like, you know, it's not really the man's job to ask for marriage. It's for the woman to ask for marriage. Okay. And so, whatever. It's Sherry. I meet her in freaking... I was in L.A. And I'm on these. Anyway, so... I'm like, she's like, yeah, you need to do AA. And I'm like, I don't need to do AA. I don't drink often. And, she's like, oh, you need to do it. Well, okay, fine. Because first of all, I knew she was not like, I knew she was a entertainer. And so I asked her, are you an entertainer? Yeah, kind of. Anyway, so... I'll do AA as long as you'll be my sponsor. Well, I didn't know anything about AA. It's not men, women don't be sponsors of each other. Know that now. So, like, I go back and go back to Santa Barbara. And so, like, I have this, I'm in this government facility. And there's this, they have these, like, I guess, a computer. Maybe they and this worker of mine, she's able to, like, so I'm like, hey, look this girl up, you know, Sherry Rosenblum, looks it up, and it says that, like, she's a VP of Fox, freaking crazy. Anyway, so, like, she wants me to come down to Marina Del Rey. Okay, so really, a lot of things are just not good. She wants me to come down to Marina Del Rey because she just freaking proposed to me. And, well, what am I going to say? You know, sorry, go freak yourself? You know? I didn't love her. I didn't even think that that was in the cards. I mean, hell. There was this lady that, when at the place that we met, there was this girl called... Rebecca Francis Wood, and that woman was the one that I wanted at the time. She was very beautiful, you know, and, you know, I guess, you know, that place was really a spot. Just all these stuff, you know, Sherry and Stacy, they really treated me like they gave me a really best experience I could possibly have given a guest at their, you know, in Marina Del Rey. Marina Del Rey is a lot like Isla Vista, except it's for, like, adults. Oh my goodness, you know. I don't know, man. And whatever, I tell Stacy, okay, give me 3 months. Oh, you don't like the way I look. Not that. It's just I need 3 months to just orient myself. And whatever. I think that we need to donate food to these rich people. Because it's for me, I know that I have to eat. And I think that they get so, like, these entertainers in Hollywood get so freaking whatnot. But let me tell you a little thing. You know, so this is one thing that maybe is reality or not reality, but it's not my reality if it's not true. If it is true, then it could be my reality. But, like, she's like, okay, I'm going to call. Okay, so, yeah, I do smoke weed. I prefer... Sometimes it's the only thing that helps. So, like, she knows that, and so she has some stuff. She's like, okay, I'm gonna call the president. All right, so she does the phone. Yeah, what's up? So, you know, really, really, Southern accent. And He's like, he's not president. Oh, it's Pharrell. Okay, it's Pharrell. Yeah. I just don't know. I don't know. I mean, he comes over, this guy, and he's like, yeah, I'm a professional smoker outer person. Whatever. I'm a professional medical. Whatever. I was like, dude, I freaking need that right now. Thanks. And so he gets a tobacco leaf. If you can put some mota in the tobacco leaf and rolls it up, and if you can have two of those, it's just awesome. Whether or not he was Pharrell or not, I didn't even know who Pharrell was. Stacy had to, or Sherry had to show me Happy. That was that video. She also promised me to show when it happened, like, I don't know, the thing is, like, even in high school, well, we know that you're gonna do it. Whatever it is, I won't do it alone. I think I feel like well, and it's not like I just marry anybody. Sherry, yeah, Stacy, were beautiful girls, but we just don't have the same kind of morals or like passions, kind of. But when I'm there, and they're like, Sherry's like talking with Pharrell, and he's like, I don't really want my own album. I really want to put my name on an album. And I was like, what? You're going to have to do it then. Well, I want help. What can you do? Well, I can do computers, sweep, mop, clean, and broom. But, I don't know. But she was really impatient. Really impatient. But, I guess that what happens when you're a billionaire, multi-billionaire. Anyway, she did do something really awesome for me. She says she had the Magna Carta, which is what, kind of like the first constitution, or what kind of established parliament, and the rights of the king, and the rights of parliament, and the rights of people, mostly. So she just tells me the story that, you know, only two Magna Cartas. Well, it's 1200, 1300, something like that. They're not having, Gutenberg Press wasn't even freaking invented. So yeah, it's gonna be handwritten. I'm totally positive, only two copies. And one's in a museum, wherever. But this is the other one. And, oh, she's like, I want you to touch it. I was like, oh, I don't know. Yeah, so I guess on my knee, I put it on my knee. Maybe I put touch on my finger, I don't know. And the Magna Carta. But in reality, the thing is, yeah, 400 freaking pounds of gold. All of Caldry. Did you really touch the golden plates? Joseph Smith, did you really touch the golden plates? You know? And so, like, the stuff that makes me just a king is just unbelievable. People are like, yeah, it's just too grandiose. Like, this worker, she's like, it's just grandiose. Just grandiose. Yeah. Well, grandiose is when you're freaking 12 years old and there's, like, this family home evening. Oh, yeah, you're the king. Okay, what king? Alan's like, how about Iceland? Oh, check my LinkedIn page. It says, I was the one They started the Lee Honda Bike Company. I don't know this. Talk about the Lee Honda Bike Company. I don't know this. Actually, this I was not crazy. I was doing bike. Me and my brother were doing bikes, riding bikes. I liked it. I loved it. And I just wanted. We started like wanting to do shows on bikes, but you know, I think one of us needed a bike. So I just had this inspiration about like an insurance plan on the Lee Honda Bike Company. And like, I didn't know what to call it at that time. So I remember asking Alan, okay, we have this book called The Book of Mormon. These bikes are generally for missionaries, because you know, we're going to want to go on a mission. And we're going to have a bike. And now we just want to do bike shows. We want the best bike. So I just wrote this 3-4 page business plan. And so I was like, Alan, you know, read this, whatever. He read it. It's like, I'm probably 12 or 8. It had to have been 10 or 11. I don't know. Somewhere around there. I'm really young. Alan is 3 years younger than me, so he was old enough to ride a real big bike. I don't know what the date was or whatnot, but I do remember right now the business plan of the Lee Honda Bike Company. And then I was like, okay, Alan, let's pray about what we're going to call this company. Okay, let's pray. How are we going to get an answer? It's easy. We're going to open up the Book of Mormon and we'll find out what it needs to be called. Pray. Open it up. Oh, Lee Honda. Yeah, that's perfect. So, you know, whatever. Alan, certainly, like, whatever I gave this company, this business plan to, or thing, Alan ends up getting a real good bike. And I remember, it looks exactly like the Lee Honda bikes that they had, or have. And I recognize that frame. Which was point, maybe even in my business plan. I remember also talking about the teacher. It's one of these teachers, man. Not necessarily a church thing or whatnot. But the idea of the Lee Honda Bike Company is kind of simple now that I think about it. First of all, you're on your mission for 2 years. 2 years. So, and the thing is as well, you get your bike stolen. Get a new bike. The math can support that because you're only on 2 years. That's it, you know. And maybe, I know, whatever. I think the point of, you know, the missionaries assembling the bikes was that the missionaries would be sending the bikes, not the missionaries assembling the bikes, which I saw on Reddit. I was like, sorry guys. So I guess I'll put that out. But, and that's just not the biggest thing that I've done, how I've affected this planet. So, it's interesting that you met a CEO of Google. It's probably, I have a list of CEOs of Google, and it's like 2-3 pages long, so... A lot of them are corporations. Abercrombie. You know that? Abercrombie is a CEO of Google. So, anyway. I've been a hacker. Like, not ever taking anything from computers or stuff. But, I've used 411 when... A lot. And when I was littler. When I was like... In high school, or just after high school, even maybe after my mission. But I remember calling 411 like 3 or 4 times to get a hold of a certain celebrity. I think the first one that I can vaguely remember is Nina. 99 red balloons floating in the summer sky. Let one go. German. I think that's the next language I'm going to learn, German. But I had a balloon company. Maybe that's what I called her. Or also her imagery in that song. But it was something. One of the cool things on my balloon company, Cameron Dexter, I scared the living shit out of him and the whole town of San Diego. I got this, let's just say, you gotta be careful about the hose that you put on a 2000 PSI tank, even if you do take it to a professional and tell them about the PSI. Didn't comprehend 300 versus 2000 PSI makes a big bang. So that was cool, but yeah. Lindsey, I think I fell in love with you the first time I saw you. I don't remember really watching you. I do remember pointing out a girl at a, voice. Let's just talk about Mr. Mraz and Cher. Rosenblum. I just don't understand. I felt so freaking in love with Wendy. Freaking her, right? And at the time she had a boyfriend, so whatever, but she got mad at him and she left me out. And the thing that I think really made me fall completely, just off the edge in love with Wendy was when she called me Jesus. Whoa. I heard earlier that was the best compliment a woman could give. It didn't matter about the compliment, it just made me feel, bam, I love this woman. I didn't tell her I loved her and stuff until years later. For some stupid reason. The thing though is we were, I don't know, Wendy and me, this, I don't know, man. It just wouldn't have been able, me and her probably would have transcended if we got married. And then this world would be left to its self-destruction. But she made the choice. We never were physical, but I loved her. And we spent years together in the same beach house, fortress, Mason Fortress. Years, and she never said a bad word about anybody or anything, and I know it for a fact. Her reality was her reality at the end. She just went into her own reality. And I just was looking at her, it's just beautiful. And this woman, she's perplexed, amazed. How come when she don't talk, Wendy Zatton never talk, hates her last name. I loved it. I was like, I just want to marry you for your last name. I'll be Mr. Satan. But she's able to walk and be in her own reality. And when it came down to when I was saying, yeah, me and Wendy were getting married, and she wasn't say one way or the other. But she did say yes in a way. Just like the Catholic, this Father John and just the whole freaking county in Santa Barbara. It could happen. Just a massive amount of. And yeah, well, there's nothing I can do for Wendy anymore, but I always loved her. But the only thing is, I didn't know what I loved her until like a year of knowing her. Saw that she was interesting and stuff, really cool. But I don't know, she's got a friend hopefully in her area now that's taking care of her, but people don't understand her. Just think she's weird. I took her this woman. So like there's this guy that I met, this captain of communications in LA near, I'm talking Skid Row, LA. And I just like, me and her were gonna go on a vacation, and I was like, let's go to Sydney. I wish we went north instead of south from Santa Barbara. But we went south. She said Camarillo. Got to Camarillo, all the hotels were full. That's awesome. Let's just go back. You know, by the way, since we're almost to LA, let me see if I can find this captain. Who's like, he helped me get my freaking head straight. This captain of communications, be able to freaking put whatever I freaking need in my freaking head to understand you, Wendy. Because, you know, I love you so much that I just don't know what the hell to do. You know? And so, whatever. So she's got strength. Because, I don't know, it was not nice. It was probably the worst date a man could take a woman to the Skid Row. Oh, at night. Well, the train was so late, 8 hours late, that we got there at night. Well, I didn't have any money, good God. So I would have not had it when I left. But I don't know. Here it comes down. So what, 12 million, billion people have like documents that say they should believe that, you know, John Revelator died, and it's in the Book of Mormon. Like, you just can't deny that these three Nephites, if you believe the Book of Mormon, these three Nephites are alive. It's just that simple. That, what, they've never met anybody, they don't work on this planet, they just, you know, are in a cave, or they're vampires. Freaking Lestat. I knew it. One of these 3D fights is Lestat. I know, just joking. But, you know, so right before I get up here to Provo and find the silk portion, I really believe that one of these light workers, that we can call them that, you know, are we here on this planet to, you know, learn, to test ourselves? Well, I think I just demanded God to give me the final test. So I really don't care what these priesthood holders say, how much they I don't even know what they're saying in testimony meetings anymore. Is it still the same stuff that they used to say 15 years ago? But me, my testimony is that I believe in the Book of Mormon. I believe that Joseph Smith was actually, you know, had the experiences that he describes. And, I mean, honestly, the Book of Mormon has not been as much of a strength and comfort to me as most people say it has been to them. But I've made the choice to believe in it and giving it my freaking all. Yeah, I was very active all up until a year after my mission. And I just, but really comes down to a choice. I mean, do you want to believe in existence afterwards or do you not? I mean, that was my question of choice, right? It's completely possible that me and every other religious wacko are as wrong. The science is just not right either. Science. So, I don't know. Is it possible that Owl City. Freaking Owl City. Oh my god. Lindsey. I don't know. I don't know. All I can tell you is I can't meet you when you're, you know, caught up in your freaking, in your wonderful show. I won't have the time that we need. You know, you take it slow. So I just saw one of your videos on that. You were in Switzerland, and I'm gonna do my hair. Totally. Once I figure that out, I'm gonna go around with that hair with the sign. It's like, I don't know what it'll say. The sign, that's a great thing about flying the sign. You can change it up. But for me, I don't know. If I had a religion, it would be love. Ziggy Marley, love is my religion. You can take it or leave it. Preach, condemn, or convert. Yeah, that's what he says. So let me tell you what's actually I've experienced. It's harder to believe that there's an actual prophet today, or actually a person. Well, this is like just kind of social math. It's harder to believe that there's an actual person with 400 pounds of gold with old writings on it that has the ability to translate it through magic. So they're in Thumbin, I just, yeah, whatever, psychic cell phones is how he shows them. Yeah, Christopher, I gotta tell you, you wanna be married in the temple, be married for eternity, yeah, as a returned female missionary, most likely that's one of your dreams. Just like put in you, marry a returned missionary, which I am right here. Really, it's so simple. All I need to do is stop smoking. And 3 months later, boom, I'm temple worthy. No freaking deal. Because what are the questions that they ask you on your temple interview? I guess maybe if you really believe and the current church, the current LDS church, so much. And there are examples that they've set forth. You know, show me, because I have stopped paying attention to them. Show me your testimony, the current living prophet of this church. And that's the only thing holding us back from eternal marriage. And then there's another thing. Do you really think that some type of, you have a ceremony and God cares about a ceremony before, like, getting to heaven? Oh, I'm sorry, you were born Hindu and you just didn't have any records of being alive, so you're just not going to get into heaven. We knew whether or not we were celestial, telestial, terrestrial before we came to this earth. I'm just saying, like, one more thing. You really think one life, eternity, 100 years of pain, suffering, and really difficult decisions is going to be enough for that knowledge that we need for an eternity? Yeah, I'm saying, yeah, I do believe in the eternity. But this Orthodox Jew told me, Jews believe in reincarnation. Nothing in the Bible that talks about there's no such thing as reincarnation. Well, Chris says, yeah, we do come back as humans, no animal kind of transfer, because our spirit, I guess, is made for choice, being able to choose and experience free will, which I guess is the big thing about here, understanding free will, you know. And I guess that's the biggest thing that this being here is understanding our free will, you know. So I don't really care about any of that anymore, Lindsey. I'm just nuts thinking that I can somehow captivate your attention, getting it so that just a sane human would love my eccentrics. Me, I am so far beyond amazing that I'm weird. I just love how you are. How you are. I mean, I've never, one of the things I've wanted to do is make balloon animals and put them on mannequins and take pictures of the mannequins and stuff. I know how to make balloon animals real well, but I can do anything, just anything. I don't think there's another person that I've met that is smarter than me, like able to comprehend. I have to tell you though, learning Esperanto has been a lot harder for me than it has been to most people. I don't know if it has to do with my focus on it or my opportunity with it. And nowadays, if I was going to start out, it'd be, I don't know. Maybe it's also my expectation of what I needed to do. And that's why I started to learn this easiest language to learn, because I needed just something productive done, and I never thought I could learn another language. The state of Utah paid around $1,000 to a psychiatrist, psychologist, patient somewhere to give me a full freaking workup. Just everything. You give me an IQ test, ink blot test, all that. IQ test, this guy, everything, give me my number. Whatever, I guess it doesn't matter. But he did say I was the most best at the vocabulary he's ever seen. I don't know. You're just really busy, and I know this video is probably way too long right now, and you're not gonna see it until after your tour. But you know, I know that, especially my father, wants me to be reactivated. All I need to do, like, Chris got his circle that believe it, and I'll be in that circle. And then, like, people that don't believe in the Book of Mormon or don't even want to look at it, because, you know, the Bible's so perfect. Don't even have the capability of just intellectually discussing the sealed portion. And then Mormons, didn't come through the top. Don't even want to look at it. Read a few verses. You know, Moroni's promise only is effective if you read the whole book. And that's why it's at the very end. I really don't know. All I know is, like, I've been through so much with this feeling that, yeah, this rabbi, yes, you know, an angel put this spirit in your body for a specific, you know, cause. And just got elevated and just having visions and about drugs. Ooh, and then, like, I don't know, you go to a testimony meeting and they, this guy at MTC, let's say, yeah, I had an angel come down and pick me up out of a hole. And yet, I can't even have, you know, my own, like, revelation or, like, my own thing, because nobody will believe it. I don't, it's just, like, I really just, you know, I just figured, maybe, you know, when professing my love to a Mormon, better freaking bear my testimony. Oh, Jesus? Well, all hail the King. King of this world, man. He said, you know, he loves you, Jesus. I guess if you say Jesus is God, then I know that he loves us, because if you choose to believe in an existence after this and that there is a God, then okay, yeah, he does want to give us knowledge to be able to know what the hell we're doing, even though the point was to have no memory of the before, just to see what we would do with a blank slate, and just to know for a fact, no freaking argument whatsoever about what planet we're gonna live on. when we come into a perfect body. So, and I think one of my most things I have to say about Jesus is that I believe that I will be one of the few, the very few, with the power to resurrect. There is, I think, something in the Mormon mythology, Mormon religion, that it's not Jesus going around resurrecting every freaking human ever. So he'll have help. So I believe that I'm gonna be the only ones, one of the very few that has that as a man to being able to do that. You know, I think also the whole thing is all about sex. That's what everyone gets hanged up on. It's just like, no. It's not that I want to be a celestial person because I want sex. It's because I want to be able to control the elements with my physical body at that time. So I think my battery is running out. So I better say, Lindsey, I will love you forever. It's gonna hurt. I just don't understand how reality can go forth without me actually meeting you, shaking your hand, hugging you, kissing your cheek, and telling you, I want to be your man. So, I need your help, even if it's just spiritually, you know, or maybe I'm trying to do a, help me study with my homework, but your spirituality, you know the truth. You know the truth, and maybe you got distracted so much and that some major questions that I've had hadn't even occurred to you, so I don't know, man. No, it's either you or President German guy. He's the only guy that I want to read his books. You can go and buy them. I can't even read his books. No, they're for women. Those Germans, they don't have the same Bible. So when they read the Book of Mormon, they probably understand it a little bit better. Not the English language, as far as language is concerned. Yeah, it's something Christopher said. So anyway, yellow thing in the sky, an hour with the testimony, but I don't know, you should hear my prayers. When I pray, I really mean it. I love you, Lindsey. Good night, sleep tight, and well, I just kind of hope that there is a such thing as a soulmate, and that we can find out if me and you are it. There's no such thing as a soulmate, and if there's no such thing as, you know, mate, one, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense for me and you. Maybe most people that don't have the celestial qualities that we have. If we're celestial, I mean, 6,000 years, I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I know that Jesus will have his soulmate, so. Good night. I love you, Lindsey.